So the best way to visualize microfluidics is to think of a tiny little piece of plastic around the size of a postage stamp. And imagine on there you can build tiny little pipes and little chambers. Think about like the width of a human hair, so really, really small. And we use them to do chemistry or biology on really small scales. What we do is we build artificial cells on a chip. So we are very interested in the cell membrane. The cell membrane is kind of the skin of the cell. It covers the cell and it allows the cell to communicate with the outside world. And we build these artificial cells by building the cell membrane on these chips and using that to look at how drugs get into cells. What I'm really interested in investigating with our artificial cells on a chip is being able to predict how a new drug behaves in the human body before we put it into human beings. It takes around 10 to 15 years and around $2.6 billion to develop a new drug. And a surprising amount of new drugs fail when we try and test them in humans. There are a lot of things going on in the cell. The cell is really complex. There's lots of components. There's lots of proteins. There's lots of other chemicals around. And so you can't necessarily tell what part of the cell your drug is interacting with. So if we can predict how they're going to interact with human cells well before we need to do any testing in humans, we might be able to develop drugs faster and cheaper than we do so now. One of the things that we do on our microfluidic chips is build droplets, okay? So droplets are like any drop of water, a raindrop, that's a droplet. But we make these on a much, much smaller scale that you can only see under a microscope. We do that on a chip and at really high throughput. So that means thousands of these droplets per second. So then once we've made these droplets, we can add the molecules that make up a cell membrane. It gives us a huge amount of control over the chemistry and the biology that we do. What we want to do is build these artificial cells to be as similar as possible to real cells, but we can identify and design exactly what components we want them to have. When I was an undergraduate student, it felt like this was the technology of the future, no? As you know, phones used to be these huge pieces of furniture almost that you would have in your house, and now we've got these tiny mobile phones. In the same way, I kind of think that, you know, now you're in a chemistry lab and you would probably use some glassware to pour some liquids together to do a reaction, but it's big volumes of liquid, and now we can do that on a chip with tiny, tiny amounts of liquids. So at the moment, they're very simple artificial cells, but the idea is that as we get better at building them, and we do more research in this area, we can make them really similar, at least to the cell membrane, to the cell skin of normal cells.